Thank you, Dr. Bulkin. I am, of course, very pleased to welcome all of you to the Faculty of Law, the new Faculty of Law at St. Augustine University of the West Indies. And I want to endorse what Dr. Bulkin has said about this wonderful crowd. In fact, I was saying to someone in the audience, please take some photos on our behalf. Also to welcome very specially our eminent scholar here today from King's College London, Robert Wintemute. I hope I pronounce your name.
Wintemute, correctly.
And we are, in fact, looking forward to a very vibrant discussion, a very diverse dialogue here today, and audience participation. I believe since it involves human rights, I do have a duty to mention that I probably in a dual capacity, Commissioner on the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. And I say this because the Commission has a special interest in this subject. And just recently, we created a new rapporteurship on the subject, which is headed by one of our own, Tracy Robinson. So I think I'm representing in that capacity as well. It is very important that discussion should take place in the academy, and more particularly in the Faculty of Law. We do know that it is a controversial topic, and we have heard much of the debate and discussion take place on the talk shows and the television and so on, very informal dialogue. I have no difficulty with that, but I do think that the discussion also needs to take place here in the university space in a very impartial, dispassionate environment, if you will. And we at the Faculty of Law can provide the intellectual space for this discussion and allow for public engagement. So I do consider it to be very significant. A university is more than an ivory tower. It symbolizes, I think, intellectual freedom. And I certainly believe that we have a very special mandate to harness diverse views in the society and also to encourage these kinds of views. But more particularly, especially when we're talking about these topics, I am of the view that a university must also be a beacon of moral and ethical leadership. So it's not just about intellectual freedom and debate, but for us in the Faculty of Law, providing moral leadership. So it's very important for me and a great honor that the Faculty of Law can participate in this activity and help to provide the kind of moral stimuli that is needed on this topic. I have always been the kind of lawyer and the kind of legal academic that believes law is a tool a tool to help shape a better society, social engineer, if you like. So it's not only about what is, law mustn't just represent what is today, but must also, I think, help shape what could be, what could be in our society. It has to help promote a just society, a society that's about equity. And I believe that there is no subject that could be more important than an individual's personhood, their very identity, not just sexual identity, but their sense of being. And I am of the view that sexual identity cannot be divorced from self. And so it is in that context that we consider this very important subject of sexual orientation as it relates to rights, as it relates to non-discrimination. And I also think that in this region, we need to challenge ourselves some more, to open up ourselves for reflection and self-examination. And there's perhaps no other topic today that lends itself to such self-reflection. I am very often bemused when I hear, you know, persons talking about this issue and say these foreign ideas that they want to bring down, you know. These people bringing these ideas from a foreign and all these things about rights, LGBTI rights and so on coming to our shores. That is very much out there, that perspective. And it's rather interesting to me, especially from a legal perspective, when we consider that the legal principles that we have to debate on this issue, that surround the debate, are very much foreign. very much from the cold, as it were, these ideas and the illegalities that we have inherited were never really an expression of ourselves. We did not take part in shaping those laws, especially when we consider that they exist within a savings law clause. You'll hear more about that from Dr. Bulkan, I'm sure, in the discussion afterwards. Savings law clauses in our constitutions, which were really simply a way of us to adopt principles that existed before we became independent. So we didn't engage in this process of deep reflection about the nature of our society, the societies, and about the directions of our societies. So it's rather ironic when we talk about these foreign ideas, because it's very much more us wanting to hold on something that is foreign, in fact. So I think as we move forward toward a better understanding of these issues, for me, there are some inescapable truths that we must confront. One is that without exception, international law holds us to a commitment to provide protection against discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation. I believe that's now a universal standard. And the other principle, fundamental principle, is that human rights proclamations and protective provisions are issued in the language of personhood, not overlaid by considerations of identity. So if we look at the American Convention, the declarations, Article 24 talks about persons are equal before the law. So there's no concept of an identity which is artificially constructed and makes us distinguish individuals in the sense of to make apart from others. So we secure rights on the basis of personhood, not to be differentiated by race, religion, class, and certainly not by sexual identity. And the other point that I want to make is about morality, going back to morality, because we so often hear on this subject about morality in a very limiting way, in a very restrictive way when we speak of morality. I reject this notion. I think for us, and on this subject of LGBTI rights, morality really should be a liberating concept and not a restricting concept. And when we fall short of these standards, I believe we fail as a society. Because the issue of sexual orientation is not simply about moral or religious issue presented in a package as an obstacle, especially when we consider the kinds of horrific discrimination, the kinds of horrific examples of violence that happen in our societies, in these nations where we see one love societies and nothing is a problem, it seems to be very much a problem. These examples of violence, kinds of violence which we never contemplate for persons who are convicted criminals in our society. So I always ask, what does this say about our own humanity, about our own morality? Those of us who say, as I heard just a couple days ago, we don't really believe in discrimination, we don't believe in the violence, but you know, we don't want to legalize anything. You know, so we don't want to discriminate. We're not bad, in other words. The problem is that we can't divorce the two. One leads to the other. So when it is that we divorce ourselves on the notion of no rights, then it breeds a certain kind of discrimination. It breeds violence, because there are perceptions and consequences for our words, for our misconceptions and our misunderstandings. They create value systems, they create fear, and words have power. They incite emotions. So, to conclude, I just want to say that I'm really pleased and honored that we can sit here and debunk some of these myths that we can work towards a society which is more just and which is more moral to change these paradigms of discrimination. And I welcome you once again to the university. Thank you.